Tere tulemast taas vaatama PÖFF TV siit Nordic Hotel Foorumist. PÖFFi põhivõistlusprogrammis linastub tänavu film Tagasi kodus. See film räägib Ameerikas Lõuna-Korea immigrantide perekonnas kasvanud Shangraest, kes tuleb töölt ära selleks, et hoolitseda oma vähki põdeva ema eest. Vaatame selle filmi treilerit.
Made a mistake about Exeter. You should be with us for that time. I never should have let you go there.
Then why'd you send me there?
Because I didn't know I was going to die. But you know what? It's better for you. If you stayed home, you might not like me much now.
I think I would have liked you more.
Ja meiega on siin Skype'i vahendusel filmi regissöör Wang Wang.
Hello.
Hello Wang, as I understand the inspiration for this film came from an essay. So how did it develop into a script?
Well, the short story was written by Chang Rei Lee in 1995. Actually written a little bit before then, it was published in the New Yorker magazine in 1995. It was his own personal story. It's very biographical about how he quit his job on Wall Street in New York, went back to live with his family because his mother was dying of cancer. And he spent almost a year sort of taking care of her. And this story is actually about New Year's Eve dinner that he cooked for her, right as she was going into the pretty serious stage of her cancer. And the dinner that he cooked was pretty much the same dinner that the mother used to cook for them for New Year's Eve. So that's basically, and I read this story, you know, when it was first published. I never thought about making a film out of it until maybe more recently when I was having lunch with Chang Rei Lee and I just said to him, you know, we've been working on this other project, a novel of his called Just Your Life. And that's very difficult to put together. So we said, you know, let's just do something. Let's just take that short story and we film it. And we, you know, really did it within 2 or 3 months, actually. So, and that's kind of the history of the project.
Can you tell us which dialogues were added to the script that were not in the original essay?
You know, I talked about how I wanted to make the film very, very visual. And I broke the short story down to maybe 40 scenes, and they were all very visual. And as I was doing that during the first few days of shooting, I realized it was very interesting, it was very good, but I also needed dialogue. I needed some content to to kind of juxtapose and anchor all the emotions. So then that's when Chang Ray and I sat down and we wrote maybe 6 or 7 scenes. And those 6 or 7 scenes are all in the movie. They're very strategically placed throughout. So in a way, it's almost like a whole film with that's all visual and then 6 or 7 very important dialogue scenes that are placed in very strategic scenes throughout the movie.
Mm-hmm. Were there any specific elements that made this film come together exactly as it did?
Sometimes when the time is right and everything falls in place and it happens very easily, it could be very good. In this case, the producer that I worked with, his grandmother also passed away and the apartment was empty. So we have a location and then we found some people. It was during the summer. Some people were, off from their TV series or whatever they were doing. And everything just kind of came together very, very easily that way. So it doesn't always need to be, war and peace, so to speak. sometimes you just have to find a good story and find the right people, and it doesn't have to be a lot of people, and you don't need a lot of money either. I think these days with the technology that's available, it's quite possible to put it together.
What are for you the necessities of making a film?
I think you do need good writing, a good story, and at the same time, you do need a lot of good experience from at least the technical people and hopefully some, experience from everyone involved. Because if you don't know anything, it might be interesting also in its own way. There will be, a lot of mistakes and a lot of instinctive things, but it does help to have some people who have a lot of experience. Because in this case, it was also shot, the film was shot very quickly. So you need, for example, assistant directors who are very experienced, who knows how to manipulate things so that it could be done within that time limit.
Can you tell us how big part of the film was improvised on the set?
Well, actually, not too much of it is improvisation. Actually, what I did was I took the short story and I broke it down into many scenes, but I didn't want to make it a very talky movie. Because I always remember one time there was a film that I was working on, and the director of photography came to me and he said, "What are we doing? Are we doing a radio show?" Because there was so much dialogue. So in this case, I really, really wanted to make the film very visual. I want to, for example, record, the son cooking the New Year's Eve dinner. It all happens in that day. And he's also taking care of his mother. And also the final dinner that he finishes cooking and everybody sits down to eat it. I think I wanted to try to tell a very, very visual story.
One of your ideas about making the film breathe sounds very interesting to me. So can you elaborate a bit on that?
I think Hollywood films today are really manipulating how the audience is thinking. It really manipulates how you respond to the film and respond to the story. And I didn't want to manipulate the audience in that same way. So I gave not only time, but a lot of space for an audience in this case to think about, their own experiences related to something like this. I'm sure there are a lot of people who have taken care of people that they love who are either dying or sick, or even you know, taking care of a friend or whatever. And I think, you know, everyone looking at the film can take their own time to think about it rather than trying to be manipulated by me. So I just present the visual information, and I hope that the audience would not get bored and you know, think about their own experiences, look at different parts of the frame. You know, there's so much to look at in a frame. You know, you don't have to keep cutting or keep going to things or keep telling them what to see. And going back to, you know, one thing that you said, learning to breathe again. In the middle part of my career, I made a lot of Hollywood films, and, you know, the studio executives are always afraid that the film is slow. I don't know what is slow. Slow is relative to me. But, you know, the studio executives want everything chop, 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 fast, fast, fast. And, you know, basically they don't give you time to breathe. And I remember I was under so much stress making those films also that one time I went to see my doctor and he said, you know, you're not breathing enough. You're not breathing correctly. You have to take your time to breathe. And I learned something very important with that. You know, I have to learn to slow down. I have to learn to really look at something, think about something, and then, you know, really try to take long, deep breaths, because that's the breath of life.
How much does the main character have the author, Chan Gra, in it? And how much are there parts of yourself? And how much of the actor, Jackie Chung?
Hard question to answer, but I would say, first of all, we were very faithful to the original story. I also respected that this was Chang Rei's personal story about him and his mother. So I would say by the time we're done, you know, I reinterpreted from my angle, my own relationship, watching my own mother dying in a certain, you know, way that I felt, you know, important to me. And I would say, you know, Justin also brought something to his character. He had something that he also, you know, emotionally was kind of more attached to. So I would say one third, one third, one third in the end. But I think more and more Justin kind of, you know, took over as a character. You know, a lot of the things that happened during the dinner, after the dinner, was not in the short story, so to speak. The short story actually ends very nicely that night. But Justin really felt that there was a lot of repression and suppression and feelings that he was not being able, not expressing, that he wanted to get out as a character. I think one of the things that's really interesting about the film is that, you know, the characters don't directly say, you know, very much to each other. It's all these unspoken conflicts and restraining of your emotions, even though, you know, the mother is dying. And I think it's for Asians also, it's very common, you know, especially with the Japanese. The Japanese tend to kind of not say what they really are feeling. The Chinese may be a little bit more expressive. The Koreans, oddly enough, actually has the same quality, but sometimes they become very explosive with their emotions. And that's why towards the end, when Justin's character kind of comes out, it was very interesting.
What have you learned as a director to hold on to? And what is not so important to you anymore, which seemed to be important at the beginning of your career?
Yeah, when I first started, I think I thought that everything was important. Every frame was important. Every word that was said was important. Every little gesture from an actor was important. And I really kind of try to, you know, work and manipulate and find the so-called perfect everything. But that's not possible, actually. In a way, what I have found more important now is to be free of all that, and you have a very clear focus of what you want out of the scene. There is a purpose to the scene, and you get your actors to try to be authentic to that purpose and to that whatever conflict is, and you let a lot of things kind of happen more freely. In a way, I feel like, you know, in the beginning I was doing very realistic paintings, and now I'm doing realistic paintings that's mixed with abstract expressionism, so to speak. You know, it's a mix of the two. And I find that really interesting and really important, because in the end, you have to have that authenticity of feeling, but at the same time have something that's also free and real and natural. So that's kind of the, from the beginning of my career to now, that's the biggest thing that I learned. It's to not direct. I only become the traffic cop. As I go older, and this may relate back to, you know, what I learned from a director as a young man, and what as a director as an old man, is also accepting how things change, accepting how, you know, everything in your life, everything in nature, everything around you will change. You know, the Chinese have a very, very important, you know, book called The Book of Changes. And it's all about how, you know, everything will change. It's a question of, you know, finding a way to be one with the changes. That's very important. And that's the whole thing about, you know, watching your mother die of cancer, or watching anyone die of cancer, and accepting, you know, accepting the end of life is a very, very important thing, because we all go away sooner or later.
Thank you so much, Wayne Wang, for this interview. It's been an honor, and greetings from Tallinn.
Thank you.